The remaining Soul Stirrers were left without their star singer, but there was a backup plan, and it involved Sam Cooke's group, the Highway QCs.
One of the Soul Stirrers used to rehearse the QCs, the baritone singer, R.B. Robinson. He used to rehearse the QCs whenever the Soul Stirrers in town. But see, all the time, he was grooming Sam for the Soul Stirrers, but didn't nobody notice until years later.
Sam Cooke joined the Soul Stirrers, determined to make his mark. For his first recording session with them, he brought songs he'd road-tested with his old group.
Oh, Jesus gave me water. Jesus gave me water. Jesus.
The highlight of the session was the song, Jesus Gave Me Water. Other groups had released versions of this old gospel standard, but Sam's distinctive vocals gave the song a new dimension.
And it was not where there was a woman from Samaria came to the well to get some water. There she met a stranger who did a story tell that a woman dropped a pitcher. She drank and was made richer.
You can hear Sam's voice break. You can hear him falter in one or two places. And yet his ability to communicate in a way that was natural, that was easy, that brought the listener in, that was confidential in a sense, in a way that made each listener feel as if he's singing directly to me. This is something you can't ever teach anybody.
And that's what he did. His first hit, Jesus Gave Me Water, was the biggest seller the Soul Stirrers had up to that date. And the rest is history. After that, Sam was gone.
Well, on that woman he had pity. She ran back to the city, crying glory, hallelujah, and did his wonders tell. She left my Savior singing. She came back to him ringing.
Joining a group like the Soul Stirrers meant a life of touring, following a circuit known as the Gospel Highway. Although it has now faded into memory, in the 1950s, the Gospel Highway was as exciting a place to be as any in America, and was trodden by quartet groups, numerous gospel divas, and traveling preachers.
Less than water, water, and it was not in, well, Lord, that woman left for shower.
We were traveling along the Gospel Highway, stopping in little cities and little towns, and sometimes having church in the field, sometimes having church in the church, or sometimes just having church in a tent, you know, with sawdust and chairs and people bringing fans and food and all kinds of things.
For all its religious trappings, the Gospel Highway was a form of show business, and the artists' touring schedules were carefully mapped out to maximize their possible earnings.
It meant that you wanted to hit North Carolina and the tobacco states right after the tobacco harvest was in, because then your audience had some money in their pockets. And you could turn out a church and there'd be donations and the minister wanted you there. You wanted to get down south in the winter, you know, farther south, Florida and so on, when people would go down there because of the weather and there'd be people down there with money. And that was all part of the Gospel Highway. It was mapped out to the degree where any given year, you could almost tell where a group was going to be, because that month was when there was money in Memphis or wherever it was.
We used to go out on tours down in Mississippi and Alabama, and the program be scheduled for 8 o'clock. People started getting at 5, you know, because they wanted to get there. On mules in the country down there. They'd be on mule backs. I've seen it. In wagons coming. I've seen that. Because I was there.
The Gospel Highway was where Sam Cooke learned how to work an audience. His good looks and natural charm meant that he became an idol for young performers like Candy Staton, who themselves were just starting out on the road.
What set him apart? He had a smooth voice. He had a smooth deliverance. And in those days, most gospel singers had a gruff voice. They were able to get throaty. They would get, but Sam was always, you know, there was a woman in the Bible days. He was so smooth with it, and he was like an exception.
Sam was very electrifying on stage. He just had a young approach. I remember him singing this song he called Wonderful. And he'd be singing, he said,
Wonderful, God is so wonderful.
And he'd be combing his hair at the same time, looking in the mirror. And I said, nobody would ever do that, you know. So the old school, I mean, the old preachers and deacons and stuff was against it. But he was selling out. I mean, the places was jam-packed. It was like you were saying Elvis Presley was coming to perform.
You would think you were in a nightclub because he was good looking. I mean, the guy was a hunk. He was pretty. We loved him. Everybody had a crush on Sam Cooke. In the gospel world, they were all in the front of the auditorium screaming with their hands up and trying to touch his feet and trying to touch his clothes. And I mean, he had strings of women. When he walked off stage, they'd all run to the back of the stage trying to get his autograph, trying to get a hug, trying to get a kiss, whatever they could get just to be near him.
By the mid-50s, Sam was being joined on the gospel highway by other singers, many of whom would go on to make a name for themselves in soul music.
Who shall be able to stand?
The Staple Singers were a family group whose younger members had grown up with Sam back in Chicago. They possessed a unique sound that built on the tradition of old-time harmony singing.
It gave us a name that stuck with us for a while, the First Family of Gospel. And that's what they, when we would go to places, the First Family of Gospel is coming, the Staple Singers, you know. And boy, we were gone.
Who shall be able to stand?
Thunder will be rolling on
that red day.
Well,
thunder will be rolling on that red day. Thunder will be rolling on that red day. Who shall be able to stand?
There's a different sound that comes from a group that's family related. You know their sound because they have the intonation and the tonal quality that only comes from people that are related to each other. That makes for a great sound musically. When you have people that have very, very similar intonations and pitches, it makes the harmony that much tighter.
When you listen to a Staples record, you hear these voices, but Mavis was, of course, the star of the group. Mavis Staples, deep contralto voice, is a wonderful instrument.
Oh, sit down.
No, 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 no.
Sit down.
Oh, please don't make me.
People would actually bet that I wasn't a girl, you know. I had to be a man or a big lady, you know. One man said, I bet my whole check that you wasn't no little girl. Because I was a little skinny girl at that. I was short, you know. So they just did not believe the voice was coming from me.
Yonder come a little David.
Said I.
With his rock and sling.
Said I.
As Mavis and the Staples family knew only too well, life on the gospel highway could be tough. Especially in the South, where racial segregation was still rigidly enforced.
We knew where we couldn't stay, and we knew where we couldn't eat.
Place you could stop and get something to eat, but you'd have to go in the back.
Segregation.
You can watch the sun, see how steady she runs. Don't
service station attendants were always a problem.
We stopped a lot of places to buy gas. Sometimes they were servers and sometimes they wouldn't. You know, they'd look and see who you are and they'd judge you by your color.
But the problems of the Gospel Highway were offset by the fact that the singers were treated as royalty by the black communities they visited.
You knew once you crossed the railroad tracks, you were in the black areas, or you could find where you were going without a problem. People would give you the name of where you could go or where you could stay or whose house you could stay with.
I just got to heaven and I feel so sad.